Hello, Remnant of the Most High God. We're continuing on today with understanding the kingdom. Now, in the podcast that Mary and I released last week, one of the things that we're going to be talking a lot about this year is this is a year of really pressing into the kingdom. It's a year of going deeper into His presence in prayer and worship. It's a year of getting deeper into the Word so that the Word of God can cleanse us, it can instruct us, and that it can empower us. It's also a year of pressing into deeper personal holiness. While the entire world system is pressing away from the things of God, that we're going to have to press deeper into personal holiness, because only upon where the character of Christ has been established can the armor of God go on. I also believe that there's a fresh anointing for understanding, for building and establishing. And one of the things that Mary brought up in this last podcast, and I love the story of Mephibosheth, that this is a time that God is going to be bringing the Mephibosheths into the kingdom and setting them at the king's table. And what's interesting is where you find out where Mephibosheth was. He was in Lodibar. He was in a place where there was no pasture. And I think that's one of the reasons God is not only raising up us, but so many ministries on the internet is because the people of God have been starving to death. Churches have tried to model the new emergent church model and so many different models that they're being taught that's church growth. And it may grow numbers, but it doesn't grow saints. And those that are hungry for more, God is bringing them out of Lodibar, and he's showing them the places where there are green pastures. You see, that's the part of the great shepherd's job, isn't it? To help get us to the place where we can be nourished and we can be taken care of. Now, last month we did film a session and the filming didn't quite turn out right. And so I want to go back over this because this is really essential. Whenever you talk about pressing into the kingdom, what you're really talking about is pressing into Jesus. Jesus and the kingdom are synonymous because it is His kingdom. It's like saying that you cannot be a faithful citizen moving in kingdom power and authority and being disconnected from the King. It is impossible. And the only way to gain more authority and more power within a kingdom is to be commissioned by the King to move in it, which requires relationship and proving faithfulness. If you have your Bibles, I want to go to John chapter 15, starting in verse 1. John 15, starting in verse 1. And this is a very familiar section of Scripture. Jesus said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser." Now, I could stop right there and actually write a treatise. Because Jesus has always been the vine. He was the tree of life in the Garden of Eden. He is Yahweh Elohim of the Old Testament. Nobody can come unto the Father except by Him, both Old Testament and New Testament. Jesus is Yahweh that God walked with, that Abraham walked with, that led him out of Babylon. He has always been a shepherd. And we need to understand that. And so the Father watches over what the Son is doing in the earth. And He is the one who helps build and hedge up. But it has always been Old Testament and New Testament. It has always been Jesus that they were connecting with. I mean, Jesus is the great unification of the entire Word of God. In fact, Moses said one day when he actually shows up, he's going to be just like me. Well, how is he just like Moses? Because Moses learned who he was from the one who sent him. And he says, now that you have seen him in me, when he shows up, he'll be just like who he made me. As a point of reference. But he said, "I am the vine and the Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that bears no fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit." And I've heard this preached many times. You're pruned if you do and you're pruned if you don't. pruning goes on in the kingdom. But how many know a little snip's a whole lot different than getting the whole thing cut off? And there's a lot of times what we're seeing in right now, I think there is a purging coming. Those that are not truly connected to Messiah, those that are not bearing His fruit because they're tapped into another source, they're going to be cut off in the days ahead. And how that happens, that's up to God. I've got some ideas, and I think Henry Groover has some ideas, but we don't know exactly when it's going to happen. And that's not really the where I'm wanting to go with this teaching. It's for us to get grafted in, stayed in, and get more rooted, more grounded in who Jesus is. But, you know, I read this for years, and I didn't really realize that in the ears of those that are, this is part of the process of interpreting Scripture, is to try to put yourself back in the place of those who heard His words. Jesus didn't speak in a vacuum. He spoke in a Torah-centric culture that knew the Torah and knew the prophets quite well. And when He started talking about the vine and the vine dresser, I guarantee you that every single Jew that heard His voice went to Isaiah 5. Because it was actually Him tapping into Isaiah 5 to show them where they were and what had happened. So let's go to Isaiah 5, verse 1. Because this not only describes where many of the people of God were in the time of Jesus. Because, you know, what did Jesus, you know, when Jesus came on the scene, He didn't say, some of you need to repent for the kingdom of God is at hand, but some of you are really, really close. He told them all to repent because they all have gotten off to certain degrees and begin building their own kingdoms. In fact, there's even evidence when you look at archaeological things, like with Herod. In Herod's palace, they had a zodiac built into the floor in the area where they would welcome people and he would meet with people. There was a zodiac in the tile of the floor, which meant that he was getting into the mystery religion, all this stuff, yet he was over all Judea. And so the mystery religions were even creeping in back then. Let's start here in verse 1. Now I will sing to my beloved, well-beloved, a song of my beloved, beloved concerning his vineyard. It's a vineyard again. Now what happens in this vineyard? My well-beloved has a vineyard that is a fruitful hill, and he fenced it, and removed its stones and planted it with the choicest vine. And he built a tower in the midst of it and also made a wine press in it. And he expected it to bring forth good grapes, but it brought forth wild grapes. Now wild grapes, this whole concept of wild grapes, we see the same thing with Ephraim that had rejected the ways of God. When Ephraim and Judah separated after King Solomon, the Bible calls him a wild ass. That he would not be bridled by the commandments of God. And so now we see these wild grapes. Wild grapes what? They're not drawing from the vine. They're not cultured. They're not allowing the goodness of what's coming through the vine to transform them. And therefore they have become a wild grape. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judea, judge between my vineyard and me. What more could have been done to my vineyard that I have not done it? Why, when I expected to bring forth good grapes, did it bring forth wild grapes? So now I tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedges, and it will be consumed. I will break down its walls, and it will be trodden down. I will lay it waste, and it shall not be pruned or dug, but briars and thorns shall come up. I will also command the clouds that they rain no more on it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah his pleasant plant. For he looked for justice, but saw oppression, for righteousness, but heard a cry. This is what was going through the minds of those when Jesus said, oh, by the way, I'm the vine. You're supposed to line up with me. And guys, prophetically, Not only was the people of Jesus' day there, but I think much of the church is there today. I have never seen such poor exegesis being hurled from ministries and calling it scripture in my life. This is no more the word of God than it is the man on the moon. They pick little pieces here and there and they stitch it together with some new age kind of thing, and they're putting out calling the word of God. They take things and they take them so out of balance. You can tell me, no, you can take a truth of God, like God's grace, but if you don't match it with God's judgment, it gets completely out of balance. Now, why is this important, guys? We're entering into a year jubilee. Mary and I was talking about this morning, and I think she was dead on. She said it's going to be the double J, jubilee and judgment. It has to be. When God created man, He revealed Himself as Yahweh Elohim. He balanced mercy and justice together. Anytime God extends to you grace, He has to extend judgment to the devil to set you free so that you can receive the grace. Anytime you reject God's grace of being free from sin, by default, it lets the devil walk free and you carry the judgment. So anytime that there is jubilee, there has to be judgment on the kingdom of darkness. So we're going to see a lot of things. And since the election, a lot of there's this sense of, okay, things are beginning to fall into place, that the enemy and the plans of the global elite have been halted. But how many know they're not going to let that go very easy? That's why this year has to be a year that we keep pressing in, and as we press into the kingdom, God's going to frustrate their works over and over and over and over again. And I don't even want to postulate what'll happen if we just stop and just kick. This is not the time to kick back in your easy chair. This is the time to get. We have been put to sleep. We have lost so much ground that we need to retake in our civilization, in our own lives, and in our churches. Our churches have got to become green pastures once again, that the Word of God is declared, that toes are still stepped on, that sin is declared, righteousness is required. The cross of Christ is preached. All of it has to be there. Because that, you see, for a vineyard, the preaching of the cross, the declaring what is sin, the declaring of what is righteousness, and how to move from sin to righteousness is all a part of the cultivation of that vineyard to bring it to fruition. But what Isaiah was declaring, he said, because you have become wild grapes. Now, I did everything for you I could. Some Christians might say today, well, God hasn't done everything for me He could. Really? Have you looked at the cross? We have the Word of God. I hunted down a book. I actually had to have a used copy shipped from Great Britain to get. That's how hard it is to find. And on the front of it is, it's called The History of the English Bible. On the front of it, it has stamped on the front of it how that the original King James Bible, when they began to print them, they had a steel back cover. How many know that, you know, this one here is imitation leather, and I'm hoping it'll last me until the publisher gets around to making them in genuine leather? But can you imagine having a steel-covered Bible? Why was it a steel-covered Bible? Because there was a chain attached to a wall, and you were allowed just so much time to be able to go into a Protestant church and read the Word of God. And see, that was mind-blowing, because the Catholic Church made having access to the Word of God illegal with a death penalty for anybody but the priests. So you have the Word of God with no hindrance whatsoever of you getting into it. You have the Holy Spirit. You have the cross of Christ. You have the blood of Jesus. You have the power of His name. What more can He do? And you know what the real thing is? We have created systems that do not allow us to tap into and yield to the vine. They are pseudo systems. And Jesus declares, I'm the true vine. In fact, one translation, I love it, he says, I am the only true vine. If it ain't Jesus, it ain't right. I know that ain't good grammar, but it is good theology. Jesus is Yahweh Elohim come in the flesh. In the garden, Almighty God would come in the cool of the evening and He would walk with Adam and Eve. And they would draw from their relationship with Him. He would come and He would walk and they would draw. Abraham, God shows up to Abraham and God says, come walk before me and you will draw. Jesus says, come follow me and you will draw and you will become. Does anybody see a pattern here? It's that walk that we were created to fellowship with God. The very breath that gave us life was created in an intimate act of God breathing into a lump of clay. And until you get a hold of Jesus, we're just clay gasping for breath. Oh man, that ought to be a book. The clay gasping for breath. But in the garden, another creature showed up. On a different tree. And said, you don't have to draw from that. You can draw from me and it will be easier. God will require less. I will require less of you than God does. And I will make you more than God ever will. That is literally the temptation in the garden. God's holding stuff back from you. He's requiring too much. He's holding stuff back. I'm the easy way. You draw from me and I'll make you a God. Oh, and it's still coming that way today, isn't it? Guys, we see throughout the Old Testament that Israel would stop drawing from the abiding of the Almighty and the instruction that He gave them in the Torah, and they would begin drawing from Mystery Babylon, which is another manifestation of what the Nechesh came to give. And it's permeated the church today. I am surprised. And let me just share this. I have learned, because Mary and I have looked at things that people would probably just fall over. I mean, some things that it'd stop people's heart if God did give you the grace to look at it. We've looked at a lot of stuff. And what I have found is if the anointing of God is there, you go down that rabbit trail if the anointing of God is there. If it's not there, or if there's another anointing, you don't go down it. Well, Mike, how can you tell if it's the anointing of God or another anointing? Fruit. There are several rabbit trails that people are going down today that once they go down them, they get an attitude. Not only do they get an attitude, they really stop producing things for the kingdom, and it's all about whatever that agenda is. I mean, that's a wrong. you followed down the fox trail instead of a rabbit trail. Now, next thing you know, you're a fox hunting down those that are, you're spoiling the vines. And I know a lot of people push a lot of things for us to research and get mad at what we don't. And whenever the anointing's not there, it's either one, it's not God's truth, and we set it aside. But sometimes it can be God's truth, but it's not in God's timing. Because God has an agenda for this ministry, and it may be different for another ministry. And so I've got to be faithful to what God has called me to research. And guys, I got a lot. It's going to take me 6 years just to flesh out what God's put in my spirit. Now I've got 6 books, and I'm really looking forward just to being able to do the research. It's like, you know, I'm going to get lost in my library and just dig deep, and it's going to be a lot of fun. But why is it fun? The anointing's there. I'm drawing from the vine. The Holy Spirit's making it alive, and you just get lost in it. And He begins showing you things you never saw before, and you start connecting the dots because the Holy Spirit the whole time is making this book come alive, and it draws me closer to Jesus. It makes me more like Him, and it empowers me to go deeper into His kingdom. That is the fun stuff. Mystery Babylon caused you to be puffed up with pride. It causes you to get arrogant. I was kind of shocked this week after I released from my conference when I was at Hear the Watchman, Knoxville. One guy spread profanities as comments all over my post. And it's just amazing what some people will do in the anonymity of the internet. And it's not of God. And how many know that should never be listed ever among God's people or those handling subjects that come from the Word of God? Man, there's a whole lot of people out there that I don't agree with. And you know how many of them that I've made bad comments on their websites on? Zero. You know, if you can't say something good, just go on down the road. And yet we just feel compelled. You know, that's part of bad fruit. That's because we've been pulling too much from the wrong stuff. And see, I believe there's a reason that we have this shallow epidemic today in the kingdom of God. It's because modern Christianity rejects the first two-thirds of the Word of God. Now, it's all the Apostle Paul had. It's all the early church had. That, plus the knowledge of who Jesus was and the power of the Holy Ghost, they turned the world upside down. Today, with the back one-third of the book, with a distorted idea of who Jesus is, and sometimes the Holy Spirit, and sometimes another spirit, we can't do anything. There's a lot of things that we call revival that are not drawing from the vine. One of the things I'm convinced of is that revival should be the normal state of the Christian. It's the job of the mystery religions to stifle, to set in spiritual entropy, and to cool the revival of God. But the more you draw from the true vine, the more of the revival you have. You see, Jesus is the tree of life. You know, we talk about it, and I really wasn't expecting to go a lot into this, but I do feel it's necessary. Jesus is the vine. He was the tree of life in the garden. When the Apostle Paul talked of Israel being an olive tree, Jesus is the olive tree that he established with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And because Abram started out as a wild branch that got grafted in, but because of that, his children became cultured branches, no longer a wild olive, but a cultured olive. Then when Jesus comes along in Romans chapter 11, the Apostle Paul says, when they rejected Messiah, they were broken off so that you might be grafted in. Why? They rejected the tree. They rejected the vine. Now, I mean, one day, all the Apostle Paul says, one day the veil's going to be lifted and all of Israel's going to be saved. But I want to read here a part out of Romans chapter 11, just to kind of prove what we're sharing here. And he was warning the Romans. He was warning these Gentile Romans, don't get haughty after the Jewish people. They were broken off. God blinded some of them to make room for you, so that as this tree grew, there would be room for the Gentiles, and then those that he broke off are going to be grafted back in. In verse 13 of Romans chapter 11, it says, for I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I'm an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry. If somehow I may make my kinsmen jealous and may save some of them, for if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? If the first portion of the dough is holy, the batch is also holy, and if the root is holy, so are the branches. But if some of the branches were broken off, and you being a wild olive shoot were grafted in among them, and being a partaker of them, of the root and of the riches of the olive tree, do not boast against the branches. If you boast, remember you do not sustain the root, but the root sustains you. It's Jesus who sustains you, and you don't sustain Jesus. You will say then, the branches were broken off so that I might be grafted in. This is correct. They are broken off because of unbelief, but you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but fear. For if God did not spare the natural branches, neither will He spare you. How's that for pruning? You see, it's all about Jesus. And here's one of my fears. Can I throw this out just for you to think about? If you begin believing in a non-biblical Jesus, are you drawing from another tree? It has to be the Jesus of the Bible that is the Jesus who created. The Apostle Paul declares, there's not one single thing that was ever created that was not created by Him and for Him. Even though some in the body of Christ are trying to teach that Jesus is a created being that achieved Godhood. He created everything. He is a noble aspect of God. God, I'm going to share this. God is so much bigger than we can comprehend. And this is something in the new book that I'm writing. God showed this to me. He goes, I want you to understand how big I am compared to how little everything else is. And so He showed me our spiral galaxy. Billions of light years across. I need to do all the research just to find out how many light years it is. But it takes tens of thousands of years for it to do one circle. It's called a Platonic year after Plato. Billions of stars in it. That's like eternity, and eternity is the only thing big enough to hold God. It's endless. It's boundless. It has no dimensions. It has no time. It is absolute perfection, and it is filled with God, because God and eternity are one. And then He says, okay, now I want you to zoom into your little bitty solar system. So in this huge spiral galaxy, there's itty-bitty, almost imperceivable dot. I zoom into that, and there's the solar system. And He said, third rock, third planet from the sun, zoom into that. And I'm thinking, okay, what are you trying to show me? He says, zoom into your study, and you're holding a 1-quart canning jar, which is what I drink out of a lot of times. It's just handy. And He said, that quart jar represents the entire universe. And the spiral galaxy represents eternity. He says, what you don't understand, He said, the only place in the universe where they can peer through and see just a glimpse of eternity to see me is my throne. And He says, my throne and the glory that extends from my throne that controls all three heavens is nothing more than a pinprick out of the third heaven gazing into eternity. And it is so spectacular that the seraphim that are gathered around the throne cry, holy, holy, holy. And they have been doing that since the creation of the third heaven. Because every second they see a new aspect through that little pinhole into eternity of God they never saw before. That's how big our God is. And that's from whom we draw. And so a God that is beyond dimensionality has revealed Himself, that which is limitless, has revealed Himself in the third heaven as three witnesses, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But what has always been true from Genesis to the book of Revelation, it has always been the olive tav that has been set outside Elohim, Genesis 1:1, Elohim, that the olive tav that set right next to Elohim, that they wondered who was the Word. It has always been Jesus that we have dealt with from Genesis 1 all the way to the last verse of the book, where it says, I want the one who spoke the universe into existence to come quickly. Amen. It's all Him. And we draw from Him. Therefore, there's going to be a perfect continuity that runs from Genesis to Revelation if you're tapped into the vine. If you're tapped into another Jesus, it will stop at the book of Matthew. And only for some, it goes from Genesis to Malachi, you don't have the whole Jesus. And if yours goes from Matthew to Revelation, you don't have the whole Jesus, because either one can allow you to tap into something completely different. That's just good preaching. Now Jesus is telling them here in John 15, you already clean through the word which I have spoken to you. Oh, that's a big statement. Why is it such a big statement? Because it wasn't just the 3 years of his ministry. He's been speaking to them beginning with Moses. Remember the Apostle Paul said that the church is built upon the apostles and the prophets? Who was the first apostle and who was the first prophet? Their names were Abraham and Moses. Moses was an apostle. Why was he an apostle? He was one sent from the presence of God to get something done. That's the very definition of an apostle. Abraham was a prophet that walked with God. We're built upon that foundation. Throw that out there. So the giver of the Torah says you're now clean because I brought the Torah back into balance, because I've taught the Torah the way that it was supposed to be taught. Since I'm the one who gave it, I'm the only one who can show you how to live it. And it caused them to be clean. He was restoring His truth, living it out before their eyes, and this new dynamic relationship with their Creator was washing them clean from the influence of the Nehesh and of the mystery religions, and was setting them free of Babylon. It took the cross to set us free. Then he goes on, picking up here in verse 4, their walk with God is being restored through the completed work of Messiah. He tells them, remain in me as I also remain in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it remains in the vine, neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Underline that in the Word of God. Some people act like God should just be excited that they have chosen to be a part of the kingdom and be a part of ministry. God doesn't need you, honey. It's not about you being here. It's about you being connected to Him. And the more you yield to Him and the less of you there is, the greater things get done for the kingdom. The biggest lesson that Mike Lake has learned over the years is that for Mike Lake to do something for the kingdom, Mike Lake's got to get out of the way and let Jesus do it. And sometimes that's a hard lesson to learn. But it's a truth. He said, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who remains in me and I in him bears much fruit. Oh, I like that. Bears much fruit. In other words, the proportion to which you bear true kingdom fruit is, it correlates to the same proportion that you get lost in Christ and draw from him. For without me, you can do nothing. If a man does not remain in me, he is thrown out as a branch and withers. And they gather them and throw them into the fire and they are burned. That's why the church as a whole, guys, we came this close to losing our nation. We came this close to going into the New World Order, and we came this close to the church as a whole being gathered and thrown into the fire because it became lifeless branches. That's what allowed Mystery Babylon to grow and to flourish and to take over so much. You know, they can talk all they want about who hacked the emails, but you know what? If those emails had shown that they were planning good things for America, if these people had good hearts, you can hack them all day long and you can plaster them all day long and it doesn't show anything but a willingness to help people and shows good hearts. What it showed was the evilness to the core. So I don't care who hacked them. My concern is who wrote them. The American people have woke up and we're ticked. We have awakened from our techno-sorcery slumber of Mystery Babylon and said, you don't represent us. What filled my heart with joy yesterday was a headline that said, "The House." All the new ones that got sworn in, the House passed a resolution condemning the UN for what they just did for Israel. Does that mean we're going to avert complete judgment? I want to throw something out that's just interesting. When you go on YouTube, Steve Quayle has just filmed some new interviews with Henry Gruber. Best ever. What's interesting is on the prophetic visions, every place that Henry Gruber saw where America gets judged and destroyed were also the exact same places that voted blue the last election. Selah. And I saw that this one guy mapped out all the places and placed it over that electoral map, and he went, "Oh my." God's up to something, guys. Our job is to press so into Jesus that we become fruitful so that we get pruned this much and not this much. That's what I'm after. Verse 7, "If you remain in me and my words remain in you." Now see, you can't take verse 7 out of context of who's speaking. Almighty God in the flesh. If my word abides in you, what is the word doing? It's producing fruit. You're drawing from the vine. You begin drawing from the desires and the dream of Almighty God of what He wants to do through you. And so within that paradigm of me drawing from Him and His word abides in me, it causes me to ask the right things in prayer. And if I ask the right things in prayer, I'm going to get the right things. Because it originated in the vine, it flowed from the vine into the branch, and the branch began asking in accordance to what was in the vine. Another way of saying it is, I asked in the name of Jesus. Whenever you ask something in the name of Jesus, it has to be in the same character of what Jesus would have asked for, because you have to represent the name. All right. Now the Messiah has come to restore the relationship that man would have had has with his newborn spirit to the third heaven. The moment you got born again, your spirit man was connected to the third heaven. That's where you draw from. You don't draw from the second heaven, because that gets you drawing from principalities and powers and rulers of darkness and wicked spirits in heavenly places, because second heaven realities always speak to the soul. What you got to do is you got to convert the soul by that which has been established in the spirit. Oh, that'll preach. That's why we renew our minds here. Our spirit has been reconnected to the throne of God, and I'm drawing from the vine. It flows out of my spirit, and now the Apostle James says, receive with meekness this word. Don't argue with it. Be a faithful student of it. Let it wash you, because it has the power to save your soul, believer. That as I'm washed, then because I want the kingdom to manifest in the physical. It starts in the spirit. It's got to come across the bridge of the soul. And that soul, that ground, has got to be converted so that it can bear fruit that manifests in the first heaven. Am I beginning to make sense? Now, out of this relationship, this new relationship, this new dynamic, like Abram, we go from Abram to Abraham. There's this transformation that takes place. Our attitudes and our desires will come in line with the throne of God in the third heaven. Our prayers and our desires will be a result of abiding in this new relationship and the Word of God. Jesus explained the fulfillment of how this works when He taught us to pray, "Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done in earth," right here. Everybody wants heaven to be manifested out there. But it has to manifest first into here, and then it flows to out there. Come on now. If our prayers are a result of abiding in Him, they will line up with the throne of God, and their relationship establishes a conduit that flows from the throne of God into our lives. And we call it answered prayer. Well, Brother Mike, how come it seems like some people have a fire hose, and I got one of those, did you ever go to one of those restaurants, they give you this little, it's actually a stir stick, and usually you get one of those with a malt thick enough that you need a straw this big to, and it seems like I got that little bitty stir stick is all I got. Well, that's all you've cultivated in your life. The more you abide, and it's this, if you have ever dealt with living things, have you ever seen like a tree that has a branch coming out like this? It's because it was able to draw from the trunk and it continued to grow and to expand. And the more that it expands, the more it's able to draw. Hint. Our priorities, the deeper I get into Him, the bigger the conduit becomes for heaven to flow. Now, love is the key. But it's not what we call love. What do you mean, Mike? Love is, I love you, I love you, I love you. But after this service, I'll do whatever I want, and I still say, I love you. How many know that doesn't work? And yet a lot of Christians say, well, I love God. And Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And He was Almighty God in the flesh who gave them to Moses. It is a universal principle that goes all the way from the Torah and it goes all the way to the book of Revelation that so many of us have not connected to because we have been disenfranchised or disconnected from the first two-thirds of the book. And we think that we can define love however we want. But the universal concept of love, I love God by doing what He told me to do, even when my flesh doesn't want to. Now listen to this in John chapter 15, starting in verse 9. As the Father loved me, I also loved you. Remain in my love. So that this is an invitation and a command. I want you to remain in it. How do I remain in it? If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love. Even as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in His love. I have spoken these things to you that my joy might be in you and that your joy might be full. So the way to cause the joy of God to manifest in your life is by walking in His commandments by the power of His Spirit that moved on the inside of you. And His commandments start in the book of Genesis, not in the book of Matthew. Same God, same commandments. And here's the quandary for the New Testament believer. If we make Jesus another God that is disenfranchised from those commandments or teach you to put away those commandments, by the very definition of the foundation of the Word of God, you just made Jesus a false prophet. When I read from the Apostle Paul about us getting grafted in, how can we make Jews jealous? How can we make them jealous? Well, I just need to get rich enough. Come on, Laodicean church, get over it. When they see you walking in the commandments of God by the power of the Holy Spirit and seeing God bless with His presence and His kingdom, you're walking in those commandments that they try to walk in the commandments, but because they've rejected Messiah, they're not tapped into the vine. They can't. It will make them jealous for Messiah. That's part of how Israel's going to get saved. Is we're going to have a church without spot nor wrinkle nor any such thing. That's walking in the ways of God, the way that God intended for them to be, because Messiah is going to be living through us and He's going to be living those commandments in us, and it's His Spirit that empowers us to do it, and the fruit of it will prick their hearts. Because like the Apostle Paul said in Romans, you were taught the word, the law, but you can't do it. Because the flesh can't do it, but the spirit can. You got to get reconnected to the throne. Love for God and keeping His commandments is biblically inseparable. It is not only poor hermeneutics, it is tragic hermeneutics to separate them. Deuteronomy chapter 11, starting in verse 22. If you diligently keep all these commandments, which I command you to do this day, hyphen, not even a comma, hyphen, to love the Lord your God, to walk in His ways, and to hold fast to Him, then the Lord will drive out all these nations from before you. You see, that's the key to spiritual warfare. It's not just pulling out the name of Jesus like it's a six shooter and you can be this bad cowboy to do whatever you want, but you're good with a gun. That's the idea most people have had with spiritual warfare. When I keep His commandments because I'm more in love with Him than I am with the world, and I seek the power of the Holy Spirit to do it, as I begin to move in my authority in Christ to enforce that kingdom, Almighty God goes before me and drives them out. What we don't realize, sometimes we have great victories in spiritual warfare in spite of ourselves. We're closer to there is a scene in the Old Testament where the people of God are besieged and they're starving to death. And these lepers say, let's go on down here to the enemy because maybe they'll feed us because we're starving back here. And at least if they kill us, we die. And God magnified their footsteps to where they thought there was a great army coming, and the enemy fled. And all those provisions were left for the people of God. How many know that was a spiritual warfare victory? But what we don't realize, sometimes in spite of ourselves, we're more like the lepers than we are King David taking down Goliath. Because God magnifies our footsteps. God magnifies the authority. Because when I'm tapped into the vine, it's no longer me saying, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. It is Jesus speaking through me saying, I just rebuked you. That's when spiritual warfare has power. Oh, He said, listen. If you hold fast to Him, the Lord will drive out these nations from before you, and you will dispossess nations greater and mightier than you. You can take on the global elite. If you walk in my ways and you press into my commandments and you press into the kingdom. You see what Almighty God is getting ready to do before He turns this planet over for them for the revealing of the Son of Perdition. He says, I just want you to understand that you're going to have to do it on my timetable. And when I say you get to, because I'm going to use my people one more time to get in my final harvest and to put your face in the ground where it belongs and to frustrate you to where you can't hardly breathe just one more time so that you know that I am God before I let your man come on the scene. Just in case some of you might want to repent as you feel my foot upon the back of your neck one last time. Because I will have a church without spot nor wrinkle. Oh, that was not in my notes. You see, Jesus in John 15 just revealed some secrets. How did Jesus remain in the Father's love and do such wonderful miracles? Out of love, He kept the commandments. Perfectly. He was the Lamb without any sin. He did not violate the Torah in any way, not even the jot or the tittle, not a comma, not a hyphen. He lived it perfectly. He is the one who gave it. He came to live it as our example. How will the church even do greater miracles than Jesus the exact same way that Jesus did them? Out of love for God, we keep His commandments by the power of the Holy Spirit living on the inside of us. That's where it's got to be. And see, really, if I'm loving God, now what did Jesus say were the two greatest commandments? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, and all your soul. Now to the Jew that heard that, he heard, you keep the commandments, you stay true to Torah. And he said, here's the other one. Love one another, for all the Torah, all the law, and the prophets hinge. Now Jesus says the same thing here, and he says, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. And to be frank, in our lifetimes, Jesus has had to put up a lot with us. And you know what? We need to show some grace to the people. Some of the communication that I'm seeing over the internet from believers talking to believers is appalling. It is absolutely appalling. And this is one of the things, when I was going through seminary, one of the things that Dr. Mack drilled into me is how many know that the Word of God is almost infinite in its depth of understanding that you can get. It's almost like looking at parodies or paradise and the four steps of understanding Torah the way the rabbis do it. Now it always has to line up with the plain text, but how many know there's deeper stuff in here? Now yes, there is a possibility somebody is completely off, and you understand what Scripture is saying. But sometimes we fight over the levels of understanding. Instead of saying, I see from Scripture, I have done my exegetical work to see this, and either they're at a place that I'm not, or I'm at a place that they're not at yet. Now, how many know that, you know, somebody in first grade that's getting 2 plus 2 equals 4, you don't hand them quantum physics and start bad-mouthing them because they don't understand what E equals MC squared means in physics. But we do in the body of Christ. We show absolutely no patience with anybody. We fight until the cows come home and write all these books fighting about whether it's pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, instead of working to get everybody's hearts right for when He does come back. Because you can have the timing right and your heart can be wrong. It's looking for His coming. And then He comes back. You know when He's going to come back? When He's ready. Not a moment too soon, not a moment too late. It's going to be perfect. My job is not to guess the day or the hour. My heart is to be perpetually ready for when He comes. If He comes pre-trib, you're going to see one fat, happy preacher going up through the clouds. If He comes pre-wrath, which I think is very, very biblical, I'm going to stay faithful to Him no matter the cost. And when I go, I'm going to be found faithful. That's my heart. Looking for Him, trying to be more like Him, declaring His greatness in the earth, and trying to be ready for when I stand before my King, because when He comes, I'm going to have to stand before Him and give an account. And for some of us, it's going to be giving an account for what we wrote on Facebook. Because if not one idle word, if not one idle word that we have ever spoken, we're going to be judged for. How much more the ones that we pounded out on the keyboard thinking that we were anonymous and that nobody would know. And when we get to heaven, God's going to have a printout of the junk that we wrote out on Facebook, that we wrote out on Twitter, and said, we're going to have to talk about your attitude. Because I commanded you to love one another, and that means even loving somebody when they're wrong, but love them and nurture them to wholeness and correctness. Oh, come on now. There's a better way. There's a higher calling. There's a higher way of doing it in the kingdom of God. That's why I teach the word. I don't debate it. I don't argue it. That's what the Pharisees did. That Jesus always got after him about. And the Sadducees did. Jesus got after him about that. It's walking in truth and bringing people in love up to another higher level of God. Now, out of honest research and non-argumentative debate called yeshiva, we can learn from one another and grow. And in the revealing of honest discussion and honest research, we can find out where we're off, where they're off, and we can adjust accordingly. But not in this dog-eat-dog, I'm going to beat you in the head because how dare you. I tell you what, guys, and I've seen this. I was raised Baptist, and I have seen some Baptist meetings finished out in the parking lot. That was before Facebook. That was called Faced Fist. What do you mean I'm not right? And I've seen men of God come in there and absolutely bring a board to its knees and repent and saying, how dare you do something like that in the name of Christ? You ought to be ashamed of yourself. You ought to be feeling the fires of hell about right now. Let me tell you something. Some people ought to be feeling the fire of hell coming from their keyboards. The world is watching, and so is God. Not one jot nor tittle, not one comma, not one snide remark that we make on Facebook dies with us. It goes on for us to be judged because it's a part of the fruit that we're going to be judged by. See, a lot of people. Jesus is... 2017 needs to be the year of the higher standard. Of pressing into the kingdom and manifesting the kingdom and the love of God everywhere we go. And that love will cause people to want more truth. And if it doesn't, then you know what you're dealing with. Well, Father, we just thank you for the word today. Father, we thank you we thank you for all that you've been doing in this nation, Father God, that we even have a nation that we can still broadcast this. Because the elite would love to shut it down. They would love to shut down every church. They would love to shut down everything that wasn't sanctioned and approved by them. Father, they're wanting to take us into 1984. And Father, what we're wanting to go into is Acts chapter 2. And Father, bring it so in our lives. Bring us to that place to where we're on fire with your passion, on fire with your presence, on fire with your word. Father, that we can draw deeply from the vine of Messiah and it would produce fruit that glorifies Him in this year is our cry as we understand your kingdom, Father, and strive to live in it. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name.
Hello, Remnant of the Most High God. This is Dr. Michael Lake of Kingdom Intelligence Briefing and Biblical Life TV. I want to personally invite you to the Hear the Watchman Conference in Dallas, Texas on March 30th through April 2nd. I'm going to be there along with many great men and women of the Kingdom of God, to include Derek and Sharon Gilbert, L.A. Marzulli, Russ Dizdar, Coach Dave, Mike Norris, Pastor Paul Begley, Josh Talley, Michael Bodea, and many more. Friends, this conference is God's great gathering for 2017. It will serve as a G3 intelligence summit for the kingdom of God. We're going to hear great messages. We're going to hear prophetically of what God wants in 2017. There'll be time of ministry, of empowerment, times of fellowship, and networking with Remnant from all across America and from around the world. For more information on this conference and to reserve your tickets, go to www.hearthewatchman.com. That's www.hearthewatchman.com. Seating's limited, so make your reservations early. And when you check out of the shopping cart, make sure that you use the coupon code LAKE, L-A-K-E, and it'll save you $20 for each ticket you purchase to this powerful conference. God bless you, and may you be empowered to fulfill God's purpose in your life in 2017.